Hi friends, Justice Gautam Patel's order in the Lodha defamation case, which was delivered on 26th April, was finally uploaded yesterday afternoon. There are actually, this order is in two pieces, it's in two parts. The first order is the main one, which is it rejects the plea of the Lodhas for an interim order for gagging me. And there is a second administrative part of the order regarding the various contempt petitions against me. So there are two parts, as I said. The first part is of 28 pages. It is the main order. The second part is of 5 pages. So I am just going to show it to you so that you guys know what we are looking at. Okay. This is the order in defamation motion. So they have given it in brackets. They are showing Lodha Developers Limited versus Krishnaraj Rao and others, defamation motion. Okay. This is in the case of defamation motion. And I'm going to also upload this in the comments, in the description below the video. So you guys can download it from there. This is the defamation motion. And there is a second one, which is the administrative part of the order, which is the contempt matters. Now, there are several contempt matters. There is a notice of motion number 180. There is a then 23 is another contempt where I am supposed to have committed contempt on the face of the court. Okay. It also includes the matter regarding the Lode Lagge video, that whole bunch of things, various interim orders and injunctions, or not interim orders, but injunctions of the court, which I defied, which I allegedly defied by uploading videos on YouTube. So there is 548, there is 243, and so on. This is a 5-page order. I am going to read and explain this also, but I am going to first read the main order, which is the interim order, which is there for gagging me, and how the judge has basically rejected it. Now, Justice Gautam Patel has written a very beautiful, lengthy order going about 27 pages. And it is written in literary English. I'm just going to read one paragraph of the first page just to give you an idea of how literary he is. It is beautiful. It is like reading a novel. Okay. So I highly recommend it. I recommend that you guys should read it. The plaintiff has an edifice complex. It calls this complex New Cuffe Parade. It is nowhere near the old and real one. Okay. So the edifice complex is nowhere near the old Cuffe Parade and the real Cuffe Parade. It is at Wadala near the truck terminal. The appellation that Lodha has adopted is a triumph of imagination over geography. Lodha uses this moniker. Moniker is a name, but slang for. So look at it. Justice Gautam Patel is very comfortable using slangs like moniker. Okay. Lodha uses this moniker for its Wadala development for one reason only. It adds a cachet of desirability and is supposed to portray excellence, wealth, and style. The edifice in question, that is what we are talking about in this court case, the edifice in question is named Dioro in the usual fashion of this builder, using vaguely Italian names for all its buildings. So he is referring to other buildings, Belmondo. He's got a project called Belmondo. He's got a project called Fiorenza, so Palava, very vaguely Italian names. This choice of names is neither irrelevant nor accidental. with other glossy materials of a promised lifestyle, it lies at the core of the dispute. Now, this is a case about a promise the plaintiff is said to have made, one the defendants say has not kept, which means the plaintiff has not kept and now cannot keep. Okay, so it is a case, it is a case about the plaintiff's broken promise. Lodha Developers Limited is one of several real estate developers in the city. It claims to offer residential housing and commercial spaces of exceptional quality. The first defendant, Mr. Krishnaraj Rao, says he is a journalist, specifically an investigative journalist. For some time now, Lodha has been the object of his investigative affections. He has, for more than a year, questioned, and I am putting this only as broadly and neutrally as possible in view of what follows. He has, for more than a year, questioned the very many claims that Lodha makes about its construction quality. He has previously written critically about Lodha 2017. I think he means in 2017. This is not the immediate cause of the suit, an action in damages for defamation, and the motion originally seeking very broad injunctive relief against the three defendants. There is very little purpose in reproducing the prayers of the motion. They amount to only this. The prayers of the motion is they amount to a plea to the court to totally prohibit the defendants from saying anything at all about Lodha's constructions anywhere, and specifically about the construction quality of Dioro at the Wadala site near the truck terminal. The defendants have defamed it, Lodha says, and therefore the defendants must be gagged. Okay? So this is he has defined the heart of the whole thing. I mean skip some part of this order where I find that it is it's all of it is important, but in the interest of retaining your interest, I'll skip parts of it. The nature and trajectory of this litigation, at least at the interim stage, has dramatically altered from the time of the suit's institution. It now has a far narrower focus, limited to 5 specific allegations. I am therefore not requested to look at the full spectrum of Lodha's plaint and notice of motion. Consequently, only a very brief summary is necessary. Okay, now let me explain this part, because only those who are in the courtroom when this happened will fully understand why this is so. See, Lodha has basically said that all the videos that we have made are defamatory. Now, as you may know, there are close to 150, 200 videos. Okay. Most of them, my channel has 320 or so videos, of which the bulk of them are Lodha. So I am counting at least about 200 plus videos will be about Lodha alone. Now, what they have sought to do is to define all of them relating to Lodha Palava, Lodha New Cuffe Parade, various other projects, all of them as defamatory. But And using this logic, they tried to have us gagged from saying the word Lodha itself. Now, the judge very strongly, very, very strongly defended the idea of free speech by asking very sharp, very incisive questions to the Lodha lawyer. This happened on 24th. for about 2.5 hours, if I remember the time correctly, he basically just grilled the Lodha lawyer, and he was not able to satisfy the judge in terms of how that whole thing can be defamatory. Finally, they boiled it down to 5 specific allegations. That was on the second day. They narrowed it down because if they kept it wide and general, they were not able to do anything. So they narrowed it down to 5 specific allegations, which I am supposed to have made. They are allegations that I have made in my videos, okay, and in my articles, in the descriptions to the videos, etc. Some of these allegations are made in Hindi and translated into English. They are reasonably accurate, so I am not disputing the fact that I have made these allegations. Now, in view of that, this suit acquired a far narrower focus, limited to 5 specific allegations. So the judge says, I am not therefore required to look at the full spectrum of Lodha's plaint and notice of motion. Consequently, only a brief summary is necessary. Between 2011 and 2012, defendant number 2 and 3, Shilpi Thard and Amit Jaisingh, husband and wife, purchased 2 flats, 2013 and 2014. I'm not sure if the numbers are correct. 2013, 2014. Is this correct? I have a feeling it's 31 and 32 or something like that. Anyway, on the 31st floor in B wing of Tower 5 in this Duro building at the Wadala site. The flats are not cheap. The sale price for one flat is 2.37 crores and about 3.5 crores for the other. This does not include a raft of other costs, ₹7.2 lakhs for club membership, etc. Thard and Jaisingh say they have paid Lodha nearly 6 crores. Lodha claims Thard and Jaisingh took possession in February 2018 without protest or demur. The month is about the only thing on which there is some kind of agreement. Jaisingh and Thard say that possession was several years late. They had been promised possession in 2015 and the delay itself caused them loss. They also say that the possession was more or less thrust on them without giving them a chance to inspect their flats until they had signed some documents. They then claim that there were several deficiencies in the construction. They noticed leakage and seepage in the monsoon of June 2018. Other flat purchasers too were affected. Attempts to resolve these issues with Lodha were stonewalled. There were even public protests in which Thard participated. In September 2018, Thard approached the Rao, whom she knew from his previous writings on Lodha projects. Rao himself was not unfamiliar with the site. He had inspected it earlier. At her behest, Rao and she visited the site in September and October 2018, took photographs and made videos. Rao wrote up an article in a blog, embedding the audio-visual material. Audio-visual material means the video. So Rao wrote up an article in a blog embedding the audio-visual material. Thard says Lodha was emailed an advanced copy of this material but did not respond. More on this shortly. The first lot of blog posts, videos and photographs went online on the Rao's blog, The Brave Pedestrian, on 12th November 2018. More followed on this blog on 17th December 2018, 2nd-3rd January 2018, 7th and 11th 2019. Sorry, this is 2019, 2nd-3rd January 2019. Between 7th and 14th January 2019, Rao uploaded several videos on his YouTube channel. Lodha filed suit on 17th January 2019. It said that Rao, Thard and Jaisingh had defamed it. Lodha described the online posts, videos and photos as the offending material. From paragraph 13.20 of the plaint onwards, there is a description of this material. The plaint notes at least as many as 20 videos and several distinct blog posts. Lodha attempts to describe Thard as a blackmailer and an extortionist. There is some vague mention of goodwill compensation. Lodha says it is not a pittance. It was apparently without prejudice. Lodha says it was for something it calls inconvenience caused due to the work of removal of upper floors due to reduction in height of the building approved by Airport Authority of India and other such factors. Now this is where the judge, you know, has really started thrashing them. This deliberate wooliness is less than helpful. Okay, this kind of statements are woolly. They are vague. This deliberate wooliness is less than helpful. It may contain some form of admission, but that is left to for a later date. Now, this points out where Lodha admits to some kind of wrongdoing. Several hundred flat purchasers, Lodha says, accepted this goodwill gesture, but not Thard. She went about bad-mouthing Lodha. She created a ruckus. She sent threatening emails. She said she would take steps that would potentially harm the Lodha sales and brand. Between paragraphs 13.11 and 13.19, there is a fairly detailed timeline and chronological delineation of events according to Lodha. There is a mention of Thard's emails. There is a mention of discussion. We are told that some purchasers filed a writ petition and another filed a complaint before the regulatory body. Thard continued to threaten Lodha, paragraph 13.18 says, and continued her harassment and demands for exorbitant compensation for the purported delay in possession. Though I do not see how a delay can be purported. There is a delay or there is not. The fact that the delay might be explained does not make it purported. Meaning, what he is saying is there actually was a delay. It cannot be called a purported delay. At least at this prima facie stage, this narrative is important, but not for the reason Lodha imagines. Lodha's narrative is important not for what it says, but for what it does not. Okay, it's a delicious, beautiful line. Lodha's narrative is important not for what it says, but for what it does not. What it refrains from saying. It completely suppresses all mention of the fact that Lodha had the entire content of the 1st November 2018 blog post and audiovisual material in an email from Rao on 8th November 2018. Lodha's plaint makes no mention of this email. We do not know why. If the other emails could be referenced, why not this one? It was the one email that spoke directly to the cause of action pleaded. In fact, Rao sent a reminder on 12th November 2018. Other than some auto response, Lodha said nothing. There was one autoresponder message from Abhishek Lodha saying, I am not available. If it is urgent, please contact Jasmine Bilimoria. And he gave the email address. So this was in the autoresponder. So we received two or three such autoresponder messages from Abhishek Lodha, and we have been sending material to this Jasmine Bilimoria also. Lodha then complains that the material that offends it was widely circulated on WhatsApp and available on YouTube. In other words, and to use popular phrasing, it went viral on social media. There is something that needs to be said about this, and I will return to it a little later towards the end of this order. There then follows in paragraph 15 a dissection of bits and pieces of the published material. In paragraph 16, Lodha says that the videos were shot in August 2018 but published later. There is an allegation of malice. Lodha says rectification work was still ongoing in August 2018. In paragraph 17, Lodha says Rao is a busybody who habitually publishes negative articles and videos against select developers and then hints at blackmail. Against Thard, in paragraph 18, Lodha clearly accuses her of being an extortionist. It says that the contents of the published material are defamatory, false and untrue. This is repeated in paragraph 20 and 21. Lodha maintains that there is nothing very wrong with Dior. The attempt is to portray full compliance and to say that rectification works are minor, not unusual, being done in any case, and therefore the published material is the handiwork of extortionists whose demands have not been met. Lodha maintains it is the aggrieved, innocent victim of a smear campaign. The reply affidavits from Thard and Rao say differently. In paragraph 20 of her reply, Thard lists the many individual defects she found on actual inspection. There was shortfall of carpet area. The construction was substandard. The internal walls were flimsy. There are wet sands under the floor tiles. There were mineral blooms in tiling joints. Interior walls were damaged by moisture. The basements are unsafe and not properly ventilated. There was a significant fire risk. In his affidavit, Rao expands on these defects in greater detail. He also confirms that he visited the site at Thard's instance in September and October 2018. He also confirms what Thard said, that is, that he sent an advance copy to Lodha on 8th November 2018 and a reminder on 12th November 2018, but got nothing but an autoresponder reply. Clearly, the defendants plead justification, meaning the defendants, that is myself, Shilpi, and her husband, Amit, we are saying that we are justified in saying whatever we have said. There are rejoinders. A detailed scrutiny of the allegations and counter-allegations is now not necessary in view of the reduced ambit of these proceedings. So now they have reduced the ambit of the proceedings to 5 points. Mr. Jagtiani has limited himself to relief only in regard to 5 specified identified statements attributed only to Rao. There is some correspondence because by an early order of 21st, this is of some consequence because by an early order of 21st January 2019, K.R. Shriram, Justice, appointed Kishore Karamsi and Company, architects, to inspect the flat and make a report. They did. I have been through portions of that report. It broadly establishes many of the accusations the defendants make. In notice of motion number 760 of 2019, Rao seeks an order rejecting that architect's report. There's some grammatical error here. Rao seeks an order rejecting that architect's report. I have understood Rao to say that while the report is not in itself false, it is not sufficiently comprehensive. It does not go far enough. He says it has missed or overlooked other significant deficiencies in the flats and in the project as a whole. He also says that some of the deficiencies that have been noted have been played down or understated. Rao's application is not maintainable in law. The order appointed a commissioner for local investigation to assist the court These reports called for by a court cannot be rejected. They will remain and form part of the record. It is always open to Rao to make his submissions in regard to the report and to bring on record at the trial or at any stage as the law allows such supplemental material that he is able to marshal in support of his claims. He is also at liberty to make an application in an appropriate proceeding to have a more detailed report prepared, to engage his own experts and to lead those reports in evidence. So, he is also at liberty to make an application in an appropriate proceeding to have a more detailed report prepared, to engage his own experts and to lead those reports in evidence. So, I can now engage my own experts. But all this must necessarily await the further progress of the case, of the suit. Rao's notice of motion number 760 will thus stand dismissed. But with this express liberty reserved to him to adduce further material in support of his contentions and to seek in this suit and or other proceedings a fresh or more detailed inquiry. What I am rejecting is his prayer that the report by Messrs. Kishore Karamsi and Co. be rejected. Fair enough. What remains of Lodha's motion for interim relief is a set of five statements that Mr. Jagtiani has culled out and given to me in a statement that I have taken on record and will now mark X1 for identification with today's date. I am reproducing each of these statements below as being the ones and the only ones in respect of which Lodha now seeks an injunction against Rao. So, from having a very broad injunction where I would be forbidden from speaking anything at all about Lodha, they now sought an injunction on five statements. Lodha now seeks an injunction against Rao and only against Rao, so not against Shilpi Thard. As for Thard and Jaisingh, I will consider Mr. Andhyarujina's submissions on their behalf later in the order. This is Mr. Andhyarujina is their counsel, Zal Andhyarujina. I will set out each of these five statements, note what Rao has to say on each where necessary, and then return to my findings. Given this narrowing, I have not found it necessary to view the videos, including the blog posts that Rao made available online, including those related to Thard's and Jaisingh's flats. Now let me flip this statement around and interpret it a bit. If it were not for this narrowing, then the judge would have had to view the videos, including my blog posts, okay, and only then he would have been able to give an interim relief. But because of the narrowing, the court is now able to consider for relief what Lodha is pleading. So, there are five statements, okay, statement 1 of 5, statement 2 of 5 and so on, and they are very important. I am going to make a separate video explaining that. This has gotten a lot longer than I expected and I found it very difficult to skip because what Justice Gautam Patel has written in each of these paragraphs is really very, very important, and I could not find a place where I could skip and go to the next place without hurting your understanding, without harming your understanding of the case. So guys, this is the first of the videos. I am going to make, I don't know, maybe two or three such videos, because we are currently only on page 9. We are on page 9, okay, of 28 pages. Yeah, here it is, page 9 of 28 pages. there are still a lot of pages to go, so I may need to make 3 videos of this kind. I hope you guys appreciate the effort I'm putting into this, and I hope it is not boring you. So thank you very much, and I'll be back with another video and another one until you have understood the whole thing. Thank you guys.